For tonight's special edition of Conversations with Great Minds, I'm joined by Michael Klare. Michael is a professor, scholar, and author, and has written widely on topics from U.S. military policy to the global arms trade and global resource politics. He currently serves as the Five College Professor of Peace and World Security Studies and is the director of the Five College Program in Peace and World Security Studies in Massachusetts. Michael's writings have appeared in publications like Foreign Affairs and The Nation, where he's also a defense correspondent. He is also the author of over a dozen critically acclaimed books, including his latest, The Race for What's Left, The Global Scramble for the World's Last Resources. Michael joins me now from our New York studios. Michael, welcome.
Pleasure to be with you this evening.
Thank you so much for joining us. Today on my radio show, I had Stephen Moore, the Wall Street Journal editorial writer and co-author with Alvin Lafler, I guess, the Lafler Curve book. And he was going on and on about how natural gas is going to be the salvation of America. We've got all this clean, cheap natural gas, and fracking is going to save our country. And, good times are here. Is he right?
You know, in the short term, there's going to be a glut of natural gas, and it's going to have some positive effects because it's going to make coal unnecessary for producing electricity. But it's not going to save America. It's not going to wean us off of our dependence on imported oil, and it's not going to last forever. It's a short-term thing. And it's going to create tremendous environmental problems, and it's going to create a lot of hostility in the places where it's being produced. So this is not going to save America, no.
How does it create the environmental problems if it burns cleaner than coal?
Because to extract gas from shale rock, where most of the remaining gas is located, you have to smash the rock apart. You have to create fissures in the rock. And to do that, they use a lot of water under tremendous pressure, and they lace the water with toxic chemicals, acids, and solvents. And you have to store this water someplace, and this is producing a massive storage problem. You can't let that water get into the drinking supply. And you're doing this in places like upstate New York and Pennsylvania, where the water supply of big cities like New York is located. So there's a great danger of poisoning the water supply of a big part of the Northeast.
Wow. So would you characterize what's going on with natural gas right now as a bubble?
It's not a bubble in the sense that it's going to end quickly, but it's a bubble against the long term of history. It might last 10 years, but it's not going to last 100 years, which is what President Obama said in his State of the Union address.
What? He said that it's not going to last 100 years.
He said, we have enough natural gas for 100 years. Well, that's simply not accurate.
Huh, interesting, very interesting. What are the, back in 1980, as I recall, Julian Simon and Paul Ehrlich made a famous bet with each other. Are you familiar with that? Do you remember that?
Yes, I do. I don't know the exact details, but of course I remember the famous bet.
Yeah, well, I'll characterize it very quickly, and I'd love to get your take on it, because you write a lot about resource depletion, and Paul Ehrlich had just written his book, The Population Bomb, and he was talking about how, you know, population is exploding, the next decade is going to add 800 million people to the Earth, and it did. And he said that he bet that this basket of five metals, it was tin, copper, I forget what the other three were, that they would increase in price over the next decade because they'd become more scarce because there were more people. And Julian Simon said, no, more pressure for these things, more demand for them, will create more inventiveness, we'll figure out new ways to recycle them, whatever. And in fact, Julian Simon ended up winning the bet, and Paul Ehrlich paid him $500 or so. Paul Ehrlich later said that, you know, had they bet on something like, you know, carbon in the atmosphere, he would have won. I mean, I guess my question is, you know, you write a lot about natural resources. In fact, the book, The Race for What's Left, The Global Scramble for the World's Last Resources, is there a different metric for things like tin, which are recyclable, than there is for fossil fuels, which are not?
You know, what's true of oil is true of everything. And what wasn't quite understood at that time when they made that famous bet is an appreciation for the difference between easily accessible resources, whether it's oil, tin, copper, or anything else, and the hard-to-get stuff. Now we have a better understanding of that. We've used up all of the easily accessible oil, natural gas, copper, tin, and most other resources. The things that are easy to extract out of the ground without huge expenditures of energy, those are all now gone. Now, there are a lot more resources left. There's a lot of oil and natural gas and minerals and copper and tin in the Arctic, for example, in Greenland. And if you're willing to spend vast amounts of money and risk tremendous environmental destruction and use a lot of energy in the process, we can extract that remaining resources. But there are natural limits to that process, and it gets more and more expensive. And what Paul Ehrlich predicted is beginning to happen now. The prices of basic commodities is rising quite rapidly.
So, some characterized Ehrlich's. I continue to be a big fan of Paul Ehrlich, by the way. Some characterize his work as Malthusian. You know, Thomas Malthus back in the 18th century saying that eventually population. Actually, Malthus's theory was a population would spike and then resources would follow, and then there would be this sawtooth pattern to it, basically. But are you promoting a Malthusian perspective that there's going to be chaos and war over resources periodically?
I do think that that's the case, but what I'm predicting is something rather different, which is to say that the Earth provided us, the human species, with a great bounty of resources: water, land to grow food on, timber, minerals, and energy. And we've benefited enormously from exploiting those resources, and that's allowed us to increase our population to where it is today. But we've now depleted the planet of all of those resources that were easily accessible, and now it's going to be a struggle. It's going to be a very hard, tough struggle to continue to live on the planet at the way we're accustomed to living, consuming more year after year. That's going to become increasingly difficult, costly, dangerous, risky, and I think it will lead to conflict. I very much do think that's the case. If all of us on the planet, the Americans, the Russians, the Chinese, the Europeans, the Japanese, all seek to consume more year after year, that is not a sustainable possibility.
So are we seeing the early cracks now in resource wars?
Absolutely. You see it, for example, in the South China Sea, where there have been a number of recurring clashes, one just last month between China and the Philippines over offshore oil and natural gas fields. There have been clashes in the East China Sea of the same variety. You see it in the Caspian, where there's fighting over disputed oil and gas fields. And in Africa now, where China and the United States are competing to get access to oil and natural gas and minerals, you do very much see the beginning of these resource wars.
Yeah, I was in South Sudan in the Darfur region a couple of years ago, and the Chinese were everywhere, cutting deals with Salva Kiir's government, cutting deals with the war criminal who runs Sudan, North Sudan,
Al-Bashir.
Al-Bashir. It was really quite striking to see this. But on the other hand, isn't it just kind of an old movie? I mean, if I had been there 100 years earlier, I would have seen the British.
Indeed, that is the case. And, this is one of those big interesting questions. The Chinese come to Africa and they're all over Africa and they say we're different from the British and the French and the Portuguese and the Belgians who came and raped and plundered your world, your territory. We come and we bring development. But in fact, what China is doing is coming to extract resources like everybody else. And it's debatable in my mind whether China's, in practice, whether China's behavior is very much different. Now, they're not enslaving people. They're paying them a wage in many cases, although they often bring their own laborers to do the work. So that whether they're actually contributing to development, as they say, is another question. But basically, they're there to extract resources to support their own economy.
But aren't we doing the same thing in Nigeria, for example? In
Yes, that's what I'm saying. There's a race on between China, India, the United States, Europe, and Japan, and everybody else to extract whatever they possibly can of the raw materials that Africa still possesses.
Mm-hmm. And what are your thoughts on the arguments about the Arctic and the possibility that the Arctic might, is. I mean, areas are thawing out and becoming available for exploration. Where's that going to go?
Indeed, as we heat up the planet, the Arctic is being affected more intensely than any other part of the planet. It's heating faster than anywhere else. And so one of the signs of that is that the Arctic ice cap is melting. And each summer it melts more than the summer before, which will make it easier to explore for oil and natural gas in the Arctic Ocean. And this does pose the possibility of exploiting the Arctic's resources. The problem here is you're accelerating a destructive process that'll make the Earth unlivable.
And some predictions within 80 years or thereabouts. Do you see that happening that rapidly?
You hear different estimates from climatologists. I'm not a climate scientist, so I don't want to claim to have that expertise. But indeed, people say that by the end of this century, we could see 2 or 3 degrees centigrade heating of Earth with very dire consequences.
Yeah. It's really quite remarkable. I'd like to get into solutions. I think we've kind of defined the problem. If we can do that when we come back from the break, that's all right. More in tonight's special editions of Conversations with Great Minds with Michael Klare coming up right after this break.
Wealthy British scion Zach Wilson.
Markets, finance, scandal. Find out what's really happening to the global economy with Max Kaiser for a no-holds-barred look at the global financial headlines. Tune in to Kaiser Report on RT.
Excuse me, can I speak with you, sir? Let me explain. My son died in Iraq.
You don't agree, but you don't have to laugh.
No problem. My son is Marine. I don't know what is happy and what is funny for you, sir.
It's an honor to serve your country. But if the country endures and you cross the border and hope to help your family, you're fighting somebody else's war and meet a senseless death.
Thank you.
Welcome back to a special edition of Conversations with Great Minds with Michael Klare. Michael is a professor, scholar, and author, and has written widely on topics from U.S. military policy to the global arms trade and global resource politics. He's the author of over a dozen critically acclaimed books, including his latest, The Race for What's Left, The Global Scramble for the World's Last Resources. Let's get back to it. Michael, just to sort of recap and summarize, we've been on this planet for 160,000 years. It's been 10,000 years since the agricultural revolution. It's only been since 1865, when Colonel Drake drilled the first commercial oil well in Titusville, Pennsylvania, that we've been using oil in a big way. And in that, 150 years, 160 years or so, our population, the planet's population, hit its first billion in 1800. We hit 2 billion in 1930, and at well into the age of oil, and now we're pushing 7 billion. Would it be fair to say that the planet without oil, without our using ancient sunlight to run our machines and move our produce around, that we could really only feed 1 billion people or less than fewer than 1 billion people? And right now we have 7 billion, and we're looking at the end of oil, and that's a really, really grim collision as a starting point. Is that an accurate analysis in your mind?
I think in general principle that's accurate. I don't want to be specific about numbers, how much the planet can support without oil, because with solar power and wind power, we could probably replace oil for many purposes. So let's not be too specific about the numbers. Mm. But the basic principle is accurate, that it's only with oil that we've been able to increase the world population to where it is today. And people don't appreciate how much food production today is dependent on cheap oil. Oil is necessary for farm equipment, for tractors and for irrigation equipment, for water pumps, to bring food to market. But also, more importantly, to produce all the fertilizers and the pesticides and the herbicides, all of that food essentially today is a byproduct of the oil industry. And if you take oil out of the equation, it's going to be very difficult, without a lot of ingenuity, to produce enough food to feed the population we have today of 7 billion people.
So what do we do?
Well, I think there's a lot that we have to do, Tom. We have to use what's left of the world's oil in a much more sparing way, a prudent way. We have to ration it among the various needs: food production, medical uses, pharmaceutical uses, emergency uses, and not frivolously spend it on trips to the mall and vehicles that get 10 or 15 or 20 miles per gallon. That's a frivolous waste of a resource that's rapidly disappearing. So one thing is to use what we have much more conservatively. But we also have to think about what we're going to do when oil eventually disappears. We're going to have new transportation systems. Now, a lot of work has been done on that already, but we're not nearly ready for that day. So we have to speed up the development of alternative transportation fuels, and other ways of producing food without oil. That's quite a big agenda.
Do you see that happening anywhere in the world?
Certainly you see pieces of this are being undertaken in various parts of the world. Germany intends to get half of its energy supply from renewables by the middle of the century, and many other countries are beginning to copy Germany's behavior. China is claiming that it's going to vastly increase its reliance on renewable fuels. South Korea. So there are countries that are making this effort.
Dwight Eisenhower, back in when he was president, I believe it was 56, gave a speech to the American Association of Newspaper Editors that's sometimes referred to as the humanity hanging on the cross of iron speech, in which he characterized war and war machines. And this was a guy who would know. I mean, he led American forces in World War II in the European theater. He characterized the he said one battleship is 10,000 bushels. I don't remember the verbatim, but you know, one battleship is 10,000 bushels of wheat, or it's, you know, five schools, or it's 3,000 homes, and you know, one modern bomber is, you know, a small city. You know, he used these metaphors, and wrapped it up saying, you know, this is no way to live. You write extensively and have about war, issues of war and peace and geopolitics. Isn't there a lot to be said for the concept that if we put a lot of resources into building bombs and then drop them on someone, those resources are gone? Whereas if we put those resources into building solar panels or wind power or figuring out how to produce food without oil, we create a future for ourselves. And if so, how do we get that meme out there? How do we spread that message?
Tom, you're absolutely right. And there are two dimensions to this problem. One is the issue of priorities and where our resources, that is our financial resources, are going. Just as you say, if you spend all that money on military purposes, and it's not available for other things, especially in times like today when we simply don't have enough money to cover all of our national needs. So thinking wisely about what we treasure most, is it education, is it the health of our people and so on, or is it preparing for war? That's part of the equation. But there's another part of the equation that I want to highlight, and that is we are making it impossible to cooperate with other countries in areas that's essential. And what I mean by that is that right now we are headed towards a new Cold War with China, an arms race with China, especially a naval and an air power arms race. This is a result of the new military doctrine that President Obama has adopted. And the Chinese are behaving in a like manner, building up for an eventual war with the United States. And this is creating an atmosphere in which it's impossible for the two of us to cooperate on things like alternative energy and global warming. And if we don't cooperate, there's no hope of addressing those crucial questions, the most crucial questions of our time. So it's diverting us, it's consuming our resources and diverting us from solving problems with other countries in a way that's absolutely essential.
It sounds like the arms race with the Soviet Union in the 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s, and you know, the old T-shirt, you know, I almost went to war and all I got was 12,000 nukes. How do we break this cycle?
You know, I think people have to be educated about all of this and come to appreciate what the choices that we face as a country are. Do we want to enter a new Cold War with China, or do we want to cooperate with China in developing the new technologies we're going to need to save ourselves and to prosper in the new century? I work with the National Priorities Project, and one of the tasks they do is to show exactly how much money is being diverted to military spending from every community in America. And people could go to www.nationalpriorities.org and find out where how much money from their neighborhood, their town, is being diverted for that purpose.
What makes you hopeful right now, Michael Klare? Assuming that you are.
What makes me hopeful? Oh, yes. What makes me hopeful, Tom, is, and I'm so grateful that I'm a college teacher and I'm exposed to young people all the time because they make me hopeful. My students are absolutely determined to solve these problems, and they are absolutely, completely working night and day looking for solutions, and that's what makes me hopeful. That the young people of this country, and young people around the world for that matter, are, you know, they're not just wringing their hands about how terrible things are. They're in the laboratory, they're in science classrooms, figuring out new alternative forms of energy, how to bring water to drought-stricken areas of the third world. They're really dedicated, and that's what brings me hope.
One of the things that has really driven world culture, particularly among young people, is the availability of electronic communication, and text messaging, Twitter, Facebook, computers, the whole, that. It started with cell phones about a decade and a half, two decades ago, in the third world, in a big way. And all of this stuff depends on a very small number of metals that most people have never heard of, the rare earth metals. You write about this in your book,
yes.
The Race for What's Left. What's the situation with rare earths?
Well, rare earths are a category of metals, minerals, really rare earth elements, they're called. They're not exactly rare in the sense that there are very small numbers of them, amounts of them, but they're scattered in small amounts all over the planet's crust, and they're very, very hard to extract. You have to use a lot of acids and arsenic to extract them from other minerals. So environmentally, it's very risky proposition. We used to produce them in the United States, but the environmental risks were so great, you get a lot of radioactive materials in the process, that it was shut down. China took over. They were willing to overlook the environmental risks and the radioactivity, and they cornered the market on rare earths, and yet it turns out they're absolutely essential. So now we're stuck with dependence on China for these materials. This is an area where we need our young people, our scientists, to go to work and find out substitutes for these materials, because they're hazardous to produce, and we don't want to be dependent entirely on one country.
In the minute we have left, Michael Klare, what is the message you'd like to leave with our viewers?
You know, the message is, and I think your viewers probably understand this without my having to, lecture them about it, is that we've lived in a world where we assume that each year we could consume more than the year before. And that's the message of advertising. We're going to hear a lot of advertising about how the Republicans are going to bring us that world back. But, the planet can no longer provide us with more each year. So we have to learn how to be smart, how to live on the planet smartly by using less but living a better quality of life. And we can do that. Humans can do that. But we have to change our way of thinking so that we don't assume that we could waste nature's bounty.
Brilliant.
That's the message I'd like to bring people.
Very, very well said. Michael Klare, thank you so much for being with us tonight.
My pleasure.
It's been an honor. To see this and other Conversations with Great Minds, go to our website at conversationswithgreatminds.com. That's it for The Big Picture tonight. Don't forget, democracy begins when you show up. No, it's not a spectator sport. Get out there and get active. Tag, you're it. Occupy something. We'll see you tomorrow.